So my name is Shobhi Khazar. I work as a backend engineer at Biostack. Today I'll be discussing about building abstractions using procedures. This is the first chapter of the book SICP.
How do you read the chapter?
So this is the famous quotation that the book starts with, which says that basically the computers have the spirits which we can invoke by using our programs. So this is a very beautiful quote. I thought that I should start with this one. So now
the gist of that quote. So,
we can discuss about the quote that. It is told that the computers have spirits. So why are we telling that? Because it can do everything. It can answer your intellectual questions. It can do stuff when you want to do with it. So basically, what a human can do, a computer can do. But by default, it is.
What do you mean by intellectual questions?
I mean, you can ask him questions and it will answer you back on the basis of the question that you ask. In case you want to do it that way. But in general, it doesn't do it that way. But they do. But when they do, is when you write the programs. When you write the program, it is told that we conjure the spirits of the computer with our spells. And what is our spells? Our spells is the programs that we write. So that is the basic philosophy. It has spirits, but it is conjured when you write the programs. So now the thing is, when should you write the code? What part should mathematics cover? What parts the program should cover? So whenever you want to define a quantitative phenomena, you use mathematics. And when you want to do some procedures, you want to follow some process, you want to follow some algorithm, you want to keep instruction sets, that time you use a programming language. And in this case, we are using a family of programs called Lisp.
Basically is not very clear to me. What is quantity? What do you mean by quantity?
The stuff that you can quantify. I mean, if you want to quantify on the basis of some amount, quantity, the things that you can number, you can
calculate it.
Calculate it. So those things you will do with the help of mathematics. And for getting to that step, that how you will compute it, you do it using programs so that we can tell computer to follow certain steps. So in order to write, define the flow of steps, you use programming language. And in this case,
So your point is, I got the essence of that. My question is, so we are going to combine that two, right? Mathematics and computer programming. So that is our holy grail for that.
That is the entire goal.
And how we were going to marry them together? So mathematics and computer programs. So that you are going to tell them.
Exactly. So that is the goal. So it is basically a combination of mathematics with programs. In this case, we are using Lisp, which is a family of languages. It was conceived by John McCarthy in 1960. We will follow along about it more.
60 or 58?
Wait.
Late 1959, so it was 1960.
So you say it's fun to programming, but that's a very subjective.
Yeah, that is totally subjective, but that is the essence that SICP
gets.
We can actually take questions at the end. We can keep a session for
then I need to keep a stack inside my head. Let's do it this way.
We can do it interactively also.
Otherwise, it will be very difficult.
All questions are there.
So, one other point. When you say that we should use Lisp because procedures can be treated as Lisp data.
Actually, this is not my point. So, this is basically the discussion of chapter 1. So, it is their point.
A presentation is being given by you, right? Not by the authors of the book. So you have to answer that.
Okay. So this is fun is the perspective.
I'm not talking about fun. I'm talking about the first point.
Processes, what procedures can be treated. So
why is that important?
Why is that important? Because in this case, you are not segregating a difference between a variable where you can store data and process which will act upon that data. So basically, Lisp says that the procedures, there is no clear distinction between procedures and variable data. So for storing any state,
Fine. You do it using. What is that? What is this? Why is this important?
the distinction between variables
not having the distinction. Not having the distinction. Why is that important?
Why is that important?
Because you are saying that's why you should be using list.
Yeah. So the major benefit of this is that because if we have treat functions in a way that you give the input, it computes and gives you back data, and there is no assignment of value, basically any side effect. If there is no side effect to a procedure that is doing stuffs on it, it reduces the complexity.
Okay, let me reframe the question. So the question is basically, so you are telling that, so this can be treated as data, right?
Yeah.
So now, treatment as data, what side effect or what benefits that brings to us in programming, in our programming?
If you take the example of anything else which doesn't do the same,
that's the question.
Place that you cannot do it in that language?
Yeah, so in other languages, in imperative languages, so in the flow of the steps.
Wait. This is not about imperative. You can do this if you.
Any non-functional. Any
functional languages. The question is not whether it's imperative or functional. The question is, lisps allow you to treat procedures as data.
Yeah.
So let's say there are other languages, classes of languages, family of languages, which makes a clear distinction between what is data and what is procedure. So what is it that you can do in lisp that you cannot do it in those languages?
Which also treats data as procedure?
No, which don't treat data.
There is no other language which treats it like that. Except this, probably. Not even SQL or. All of them have a lot of syntax.
If you are saying we should be using Lisp because of this, then the question is what abilities does it give us as programmers or makers of software, which I don't get in that language, and which is why it should be using this?
Yeah, so I think that the major benefit that this aspect brings is reduction of complexity. And why reduction of complexity? Is because suppose your program makes changes to states of values at some point in time. So now it is very convoluted at which part this change is being made.
List.
But if you are
you are talking about the immutability kind of thing.
No,
actually related to exactly what immutability
is. So, your point is not related to your answer. Mm-hmm. So, we should get to it at the end of the
question. Okay.
Also, we can discuss it now also.
Also, Lisp is not only functional. Lisp is pretty much allows to change. There is a dialect of Lisp for common Lisp. You can do anything in it. You get data and all this. What you are talking, might be.
Even if immutability is not there.
No. It's not a functional language at all. So you can, what you are talking is might be true in terms of clojures, but not in terms of common lisp or other dialects.
Yeah, so in this case actually I'll be using clojure, not there is some other language.
SICP is not written on clojure, it's written on scheme.
Yeah, it is written on scheme, but
anyway, we are digressing. The point is your answer is not at all related to that point. So we should get to it at the end.
So we can discuss it now because it is anyway impact.
Let's move on, we'll get to it at the end. Because that will be a whole long discussion.
Okay, that's fine. So we are not using, so SICP prefers to use a language. Combinations can be nested in case of infix expressions also, but In this case, it would be less complex and more intuitive. And obviously, it is actually easy for the interpreter to read because in any way, infix expression is converted to prefix expression by the compilers.
So what is combination? Basically, what do you mean by combination?
A combination of nesting of so the operand, so there is an operator, then operands. So now you can have multiple of operands to an operator. And the number of operators used would be very less.
So,
okay, yeah, if you put some examples, then it will be better to understand like this. Okay, so you can use that code.
Anyway, so in this case, so if in the normal infix expression, if we are using this one, it would be the square expression would be x into x, but in this case, we just write it this way. There are ways to convert it, but I will discuss it in later parts maybe, that how you are converting it. So,
ways to convert to what?
An infix operation, in case you are comfortable with that, so because of the people not coming from this background.
What we can do here is probably try and contrast between the infix and prefix notation using more than two arguments. Then maybe your point might be more clear.
More than two arguments. So yeah, actually this was present in the previous example. So let's suppose the first example, if you write it in an infix operation. So the point was arbitrary number of arguments and see the number of times the operator is being used. So this is 21 plus 35.
Yeah, you require 4 or 5 operands. So that's.
Yeah, so the number of times that it would be used would be lessened by lot number. But
so in school mathematics, we are accustomed to do this kind of infix operation. Okay. So what?
So another so how this procedure is helping us abstract from the inner implementation is that if even if you have compound operations, you can name it and then later you can use the name to refer to the step of this flow of steps. So that is basically the abstraction. What I mean is that suppose there is a function which does a lot of things, let's say n number of things, but now you name it something, you name it anything, let's suppose test, and now you can refer to the flow of steps, multiple steps by a single term, which is the name of the function. This is basically the level of abstraction because now you don't need to know what is the inner implementation, it is like a black box. Now you can put values to it to get a computed result back or let it do some operation.
Okay.
So
can I interrupt someone?
Yeah.
So I guess the essence of this is that so you we are going to build one big compound piece of software or function. Okay. So what is the procedure? So what is abstraction? So abstraction is basically you are not going to build the entire thing together, right? So in one piece.
It is like ignoring the implementation detail. Yeah.
So in your in this particular sheet, so you are right. I mean that is referred as a unit. So what is unit? So unit is the smallest type of stuff that you are going to build.
Yeah.
In the unit, you need to combine the different units to build the bigger unit.
Yes.
So that's the point I get.
Yeah. So this can refer to as a unit. Then another unit can refer to it as a combination of multiple of that units. Then again that unit can be a combination of multiple of such units. So that is the level of abstraction keeps increasing and that is basically our goal so that we can abstract as much as possible. So that because maybe in this case you are doing square by multiplying the number with itself, but maybe we can do it using some power operations, we can inject some power libraries here to do the same. But the point is that if I want to get the square, I will use the square, but I am abstracting myself from the implementation feature. So that is basically the goal. So now let's talk about what is the substitution model for decision application. So what is the meaning of that? So let's say I want to calculate the fourth power of a number. So there are multiple ways to go about it. But let's suppose we have its unit predefined, we have self-defined it. So now you can see quad is actually making use of square. And so basically when we are trying to evaluate this quad procedure, we are basically substituting it with its building blocks. So you can see basically quad is actually a composition of two times of square expression. So this is, we are substituting the values when we are going to provide the output of that procedure. Now we can see that there are basically two types of models which lets you substitute the building blocks.
Okay, 1 minute. So you need to find the fourth power of numbers. I guess how you build the unit is the even number of n. We can find the even power of a number, but not the odd one. Okay. So how to do that? So what's your suggestion to build the unit so that we can build even as well as odd number of powers? That should be there. Okay. Anyway.
Yeah. I mean that is actually implementation detail. So how you want to calculate? So in this case, this is just an example that I want to calculate. So we can abstract from it. So in this case, we are using square function, but maybe we don't use square function, maybe we use something else. But that is the goal that we want to abstract from the implementation detail. So now, how the substitution, the two major types of substitution models, so we are going to discuss that. First one is applicative order. So what applicative order says is that we are not going to break it down into very atomic level so that it cannot be broken down any further. Instead, we are going to apply it straight onwards on the given operands. So as you can see, it applies the resulting procedure to the resulting argument. So let's say even the arguments are some procedures. So in the first step, the result of this procedure is basically applied to the first level operator. Directly, we are not going to break it down any further and we apply it straight away. So that is what is meant by evaluate the arguments then apply. It is supposed to be more efficient because since we are not breaking down all the operators, so it ignores the places where there are multiple times same operation is being done. So in that example where I was doing a square of a number, so if you would have been breaking it down completely, so we might be doing some operation multiple times, but which could have been done in a much higher level instead. So in that way it is called an efficient version than the normal order, but now we'll see what is actually the normal order.
So this is called applicative. So is this related to the category theory, applicative and some sort of
normal? I don't know category.
But applicative terms actually belongs to an
if. Probably not in SICP. SICP never talks of category. SICP is a category theory. Haan, nikhe kalhe sa thang rehi bol. Either topon chido
bana. Haan, it's totally category theory.
Haan, no, no. Mushta the Python kata ne? Dino Python na bani.
Category theory is not something related to any particular programming language. So it's
but they don't talk of it.
So now we are going to talk about the second type of evaluation that we can see, that is the normal order. And in normal order, what we do is that first we break down the procedures into the most primitive form, atomic form that we can get, so that it cannot be broken down any further. And when it is in the primitive form, then we start reducing it, we start computing it. That's why it is called fully expand then reduce. So we reduce it completely. Once the fully expand first, then we reduce. So when the expansion is complete, now it cannot be broken down any further, then we start reducing it. So that is why it is also called lazy evaluation, because you don't compute it straight away, rather you let it break it down any further that it can get. As a result, sometimes it can get more complicated, and since we are always breaking it down further, so there can be some steps which are repeated more than once. So that's how the process, the concept of applicative order being more efficient comes to place. So that's how we can say that that is a bit more efficient.
Do you know
why clojure applies either?
No.
Normal order, applicative order. So scheme uses applicative order. It uses that that interpreter uses that principle of substitution. Normal order, I haven't seen in any.
Sequence is a normal order, right? When clojure uses sequence.
Scheme.
There are lots of things. Very related in clojure.
Definitely. I'm not sure.
In Java,
but actually, scheme uses applicative order.
Oh, there is no lazy evaluation in scheme? Maybe.
Lazy evaluation, but internally, scheme
is
applicable.
Internally, applicative order for the lazy evaluation for the
lazy order, lazy evaluation to internally.
According to my study, scheme dialect of Lisp uses applicative order. But some other languages also use normal.
Scheme is very small, it makes sense.
It is very beautiful. So now.
It is a scheme record. Record to the scheme record.
This is actually a problem given in SICP in order to just understand the difference between these two. So that is actually a scheme code. So anyway. It says that it has defined two procedures. Now it is making one combination of procedures just to see how different it can be. So this part is actually the answer. So in applicative order, if you see, since we apply it in the very first place on the given operand, so if P is defined as when you invoke P, you get P. And if test xy is defined such that if x is equal to 0, you return 0, otherwise you return y. In that case, if you combine these two and have test 0 and p as the argument to this procedure, then you see, since in normal order, we tend to break it down further, and once it is in the primitive form, then only we reduce it. So you see, 0 can be, first expression can be broken down easily and applied easily and you get 0 back. But when you try to evaluate p, you get p back. So this loop actually continues, you try to evaluate p, you get p. This evaluation continues and hence in normal order you are not going to get any response because it is going to be there is not going to be any perturbation. But in applicative order, since you apply it directly, so you can see that since test is the test procedure, it basically says if it is equal to 0, use 0, otherwise you get y. So you see when it is given two arguments, 0 and p, and since in the
so you are saying condition, in applicative evaluation, this will terminate.
This will terminate.
In normal order, this won't terminate because p keeps on
infinite. P keeps on going.
Recursive on itself without a base condition.
Without a base condition. It will never hit a base condition. So, so that is the answer. And now, some conditional expressions that you see, the basic building blocks. There are many ways you can write conditional expressions in different languages. So, this is just one type using a if statement. I'm making use of that. So now the question is that you can take three arguments and return the sum of the square of the larger two numbers. So I'm using very plain and simple. Since the square method has already been defined, so I'm abstracting from there and using it directly here. Now I'm telling that if in first two arguments whichever is bigger, I'm making use of that. In other case, the second two remaining arguments, I'm checking which one is bigger than that. Then I'm making square of both, then I'm doing a plus expression on that. So basically this is the combination of
is this correct? I'm thinking otherwise. If x is greater than y, then x will be beat. If y is greater than z, maybe one of them will be beat. What happens if x is greater than also?
There can be a condition actually. I just wrote it just to show combination of. just for stating the question. And now, what is the difference between a function that is written in mathematics versus the functions and procedures written in programming languages? So, procedures, as we see in programming languages, it tells us series of steps that if you are going to do something, how you are going to do it. But in functions, in mathematics, it is declarative as to say that if this is the function you want to get this, there is a predefined set of what it is, how you are going to do it. So if it is a square, so what is a square? That is basically the explanation of functions in mathematics. So now I'm going to come to the main point of this presentation, that how you are going to abstract, what is abstraction in the basis of procedures that we write. So since we saw in the quad function that quad is further dependent on a procedure called square.
Yeah, so you make one confusion. So you already mentioned that you are not going to use scheme, you are going to use clojure, but
yeah, actually this is just the example.
It's little, I mean, confusing, yeah, okay.
Yeah. So in closure, there's a little bit of syntax difference, but I'm just...
I think you know, right? There is a closure version of SICP.
Mm-hmm.
On your... yeah. Someone wrote it.
That's it, that's
it.
Hello?
Hey, Momo.
Building ke niche, 23M.
Tumhi bolo, Momo.
Yeah, cheek it, give me a...
ओके इटा बोला था वही इटा फ्लोसन कलर में बिल्डिंग मजे नहीं छुने तो ये कुछ ज़्यादा हमारा
नंबर टू पढ़ा
चुका है व्हाट्सएप में चल
चुका है हाँ नंबर टू व्हाट्सएप पढ़ा चुका है तो
मेरे को बोला था फ्लोसन कलर में बिल्डिंग ऐसे होने चुका है मतलब तो बिजी भी
चुका है इतने ऑन एट लोग तो चुना है बिल्डिंग के बाहर आ गई ऑर्डर डीसी ला गए कोई बार
वॉक स्पॉट इंडिया
कुछ छोड़ कोलकाता बोल ले
बाय इसका लोकेशन
तो मैं ये लोकेशन में चुना
है मुझे जो मुख्य टोनी से मारो तो अपन पास टोनी से हम तो वो दिए ना
बा वही पास है रास्ता में
So now the main crux of this presentation, that I'm trying to define abstraction on the basis of procedures that we write. How you can abstract, what is the concept of abstraction on the basis of procedures? So the point is that a procedure can be based on multiple sub procedures which it is making use of. So as you can see, there can be multiple procedures underlying the main procedure, but actually it doesn't matter which procedure you use. Let's say in the square procedure that we define, you can do it in a mathematical way by using exponents of the double or the log of it, or you can double it four times like that, but it actually doesn't matter that how you are going to do the square of it. So that's the point, that you are trying to abstract yourself from the implementation detail, that it doesn't matter. It might be that there are multiple underlying procedures that you can use, but in your case, you are abstracting yourself from the level of square. So anything underneath it is, actually you don't care about it, because there can be multiple ways you can go about it. So that is basically the abstraction that we are talking about in terms of procedures. So it doesn't matter what you use. Thing is that it is like a black box. You give stuff, you get stuff, or you give stuff and something works that way.
You come to a meetup server. Yeah, black box.
Yeah, so that's it.